do our best. As you can, I guess the present mode is coming up. The first slide says, let's see, just with this, I can't even see the slides here. So we are all working through this. First slides should say, just one second. Thank you guys for your patience as we all work through this. Let's see here. Okay, Ms. Sanders, can you get to the slide?
Good.
Can you get to the slide where it says slide three, keep calm, because I, on my screen, I can't see the presentation here. Okay, there it is. All right, can you go to present mode? Over to the next slide, please. Okay, so this first one, keep calm, survive senior year. Obviously, it's going to be a tough thing for all of us as we are doing things so differently this year, and I've had to tell myself this many times. And so while we're saying it to our students and parents, we too also need to make sure that we are doing our best, understanding that we will make it through day at a time, 1 minute at a time, 1 hour at a time. If you can go to the next slide, Ms. Sanders. The application process can be overwhelming, but we're going to do our best to try and keep it simple and make sure we have appropriate resources for our students and parents as we go through this process. Mr. Millett is here, and so he has the last part of the alphabet. I have the first half. I also am responsible for A's Academy students, and Ms. Brenner is responsible for the Great Oaks students. And then Ms. Sanders is our administrator for the class. Sorry about that. All right, so bell schedule. We have a new bell schedule this year. We do release a little earlier. Some of the class periods are shorter. One thing to keep in mind, you'll see on this schedule that lunch is going to be after six bell. So for the students that have early release, they will be able to leave after six bell, so they are not required to stay for lunch. Obviously, this will help cut down on the number of students in the commons when we have lunch. And so for all of the students that are early release, they do have that option to leave after six bell and not stay for lunch. So that would be a dismissal at about 12:30, which is different from the bell schedule in the past where six bell did not end until about 1:30. With our office hours, we do have some students that are going to be virtual this year. And so we have some office hours dedicated strictly to them. I have a pre-existing health condition, so I will not be in the building on my virtual hour time. So I will make sure I share this with all the students, and during those virtual hour times, everyone will get a Google Meet invite and they can just connect with me virtually. So that's why Mr. Millett's virtual hours are slightly different from mine due to that situation. All right, Ms. Sanders, we'll go on to the next slide.
All right, hello, this is Mr. Millett. I wanted to run through a few slides now. The first one is how we communicate. There are like a lot of different facets and ways that we do send out messages. The first is through the Sycamore student email account. I think the big thing with us is to make sure that no one is missing out like on anything. And so we did use the Remind app as well starting last year, and I think that we both found that to be like extremely helpful. And I found that as just like another way to help like communicate with students, especially during the day. I will say that if you do not have an account on there, that you can still do that. And that would be texting the number, which is 1010. And in that message, you would type at B2H382. So if you are not on the Remind app and it would like to do that, that is how that you would do that. We sent out some information, I think earlier today, actually.
Yeah, earlier today, like for students who are interested in majoring in business at UC, we just were able to quickly send a, it goes right to their phone, and we found that students definitely are more responsive to that than they are to email, obviously. So we will continue to use that method.
And then that we, and just like I said earlier, that we do have various platforms. And so some people use, let's see, Facebook, Instagram, and the same information is going to be communicated out through those various platforms. Next slide. That is just an example of that, and just some different items that we, I mean, shared out there, such as fun facts, college updates, trips, deadlines. Next slide. And it, our counseling website is an important tool that we do use to communicate. So it's here that we have different videos and tutorials that you can access calendars and just various like grade level information, financial aid information, overgrad links. There is also a spreadsheet link that we update scholarship information that will typically be added in September and throughout the fall as we receive that information. So if you go on there now, some of that may be from the prior year that we have not yet received that information. And just another, and then just another item of note is going to be the student opportunities page. And that there will be like a link there, like career programs, community volunteering opportunities, and be on the lookout for the newsletter that we send out. That is going to be every other week. And I think our first newsletter goes out on this next Monday.
Yep, the 24th.
Yes.
Okay, the college application process. So to start off, the way students apply, typically most students will use the Common Application website because there are over 700 colleges that are on the Common Application site. Some schools are not, who are not on Common App, the student would apply through the website. Requesting transcripts through Overgrad, that is something that is the next step. And for both Common App and requesting transcripts through Overgrad, we do have videos on the counseling website where the it's called the Pit Stop. And so it's like for grade 12. I was very excited this morning. I think over 275 students or parents or whomever have viewed the Common App video. So we're glad to see that that's being utilized. After students request their transcript, the next thing is sending test scores. And we'll talk about that a little bit because that has changed as far as some of the requirements for some of the colleges. And then lastly is paying the application fee. Some other things that may be included in the college application process, student essays, letters of recommendation, extracurricular activities, resume, and in some cases, maybe even an interview. So when we talk about the common application, as I stated, the common application is just a website where students can go, and because there are about 800 schools on the website, a lot of students will need to go there. And it just allows that one platform. An example of some of the common application schools, Ohio State, UC, Miami, Michigan, Purdue, North Carolina, Virginia, all of the Ivies, Kent State. And the great thing that I like about what they have changed regarding the Common Application, if there is a school that does not require an essay, when students will still do the Common Application, but an essay may not be required. So sometimes that's a myth where students think, oh, I have to write an essay if I'm going on the Common Application. There are some schools, for example, Bowling Green doesn't require an essay. And so when the students get to that particular page, they would say no essays required. So this is an example of some of the Common Application schools. The majority of the schools in our area are on the Common App. Now with Overgrad, and these are two different platforms the students have to manage. And so sometimes students think that, okay, I've completed the Common Application. I don't have anything left to do. All college applications must be listed in Overgrad. For a lot of parents and students that we've met with, when we've gone to that scattergram where it shows, you know, like dots to show all the students that have applied and been accepted, that's how we track that data. So that's why it's very important for students to make sure they list all of their college applications in Overgrad. We will send transcripts through Overgrad, and that's also where they can track their application status. And then for those that still are in the process of researching some schools and college majors, Overgrad also allows students to do that. So Overgrad is used for the research area, but also for listing those applications and requesting transcripts. Next slide.
Next slide. So I'm going to review some of the COVID-19 changes. And just obviously the fact that we are going to do this virtual presentation this way is just kind of showing how, you know, that there has been effect like on all of us. And I just want to highlight some items where this will be evident. And so in some ways, our policy for grading changed the second semester of junior year to pass fail, and this was not like within a vacuum, and that high schools all around the country had to change their policies due to the pandemic. And I want to make sure that everybody knows that those like admissions officers at colleges do know of this situation, and that the pass-fail grades will not negatively impact students. In our school profile that we send to colleges, this will be clearly outlined. Next slide. With that being said, I do recall communicating the importance of taking a rigorous but balanced schedule during the junior year. I do think this is also true this year just as much. Colleges will ask for mid-year reports, and so they want to see the academic performance is consistent during that first semester.
And also on the transcript, when we send the transcripts, it will also show for those schools that will be making a decision prior to the semester ending, they will see the schedule of every student. And so they will definitely take that into account. So we're encouraging students to continue with that rigor their senior year. Just don't slack off, for lack of a better word.
Yeah. And let's see, next slide is test optional. And so almost all of the universities will be test optional for the upcoming admission cycle. If a student feels that their score reflects their abilities, then they should submit them. Colleges are also, aware that the student may not have the same composite score if they only took, let's say, one test versus maybe taking it three or four times. Next slide. So this is an example of an institution that is going test optional, but please pay close attention to each of the specific colleges, because though they may say that they're test optional, that may not be the case for like specific admission within maybe Honors College or a specific college within the university.
It's like for this one, we received an email from University of Louisville saying we're test optional. I was like, oh, that's great. And then I look at the fine print and then it says that they are test optional, but not for Honors College, not for the School of Nursing, College of Business, Engineering. And so, you know, kind of like you said, you're test optional, but that does not, you know, include a lot of those students who are going to be applying to those three schools. So we are just encouraging students to take a close look. Obviously, with them being thousands of schools out there, I would love to be able to say, okay, I know this school and this school requires the test for nursing and engineering, but unfortunately, because every school is different, we can't know that information off the top of our head. So we definitely encourage students to make sure that they utilize the website of the colleges to get the most up-to-date information and, you know, click on those links so that they know that additional information.
Yeah, next slide. So if you do plan to send your scores out, this is something that is similar in, as in past years. So you will need to send this, you will need to get in touch with the testing agency to send those scores directly to each college. And so let's see, college rep visits. So this is the first year that we will plan to do all virtual college rep visits. This is something that we have not done before. And I think colleges are now extremely open to this, knowing that they may not travel as well. And so we will plan to start to schedule these in the month of September, and we plan to not have them run during the day, but towards the end of the afternoon. And so we have also added college rep contact information on our pit stop page. So let's say if they have practice after school and they can't attend a virtual visit, is they can still reach out to that college, to the admission person. Let's see, letters of recommendation.
Yeah. Okay, so for letters of recommendation, these can be submitted through Common App. Students will go when they're in the Common application, and it's definitely a lot clearer on the video that we have on the pit stop where you can see where students go in. I think it's important when we talk about not asking for more than needed. A lot of the colleges, they've taken a lot of time and assess their graduating classes over, you know, incoming classes over the last years, and they've determined what they feel is an appropriate number of recommendation letters. We ask that students give counselors and teachers at least 2 weeks to be able to write a quality letter. So that's obviously very important. I know that Mr. Millett and I think we each have about 25 students apiece,
yeah,
that have already gone through the common application and requested our recommendation letters. And so we are definitely very happy to see that that's being used. If you go to the next slide, you will see this is what your students see when they're on the common application. And I know it might be hard to see, and we will be sending an email of this presentation so that you can see it in a larger format. But under the teacher section, this is for Ohio State. And you can see for the teacher section, it says required zero and optional one. What that means is that they are only allowing one letter to be uploaded. So for students who maybe say, oh, I'm asking three teachers to write me a letter. Once one letter is uploaded, that's it. There are not any additional letters that can be uploaded. So I want to make sure that I wanted you guys to just kind of see what this looks like. And also so the students can see that they can't, they really don't have a way to send a lot more letters than what's required. So just wanted you guys to see that. As I stated earlier with the information, the college's website is where you're going to find the most accurate and up-to-date information. Keep in mind on Overgrad, links to the admissions page of each college can be found on that overview page. So we try and make it as convenient as possible. But just know that this is especially important now more than ever. I mean, I anticipate there may be deadlines that change mid-year where, I mean, I've been on several webinars with colleges and they're like, you know, we have to pivot, we have to make some changes. And so our dates may change. Like I know Ohio State moved their deadline from November 1st to November 15th. It may be possible a school, you know, says that based on, because we have to keep in mind that they have to keep all of the other states in mind when they're making these decisions, because they are receiving thousands and thousands of applications. So they very well may decide that, oh, we need to push back our deadline. So just make sure that trying keeping up with those websites for that most up-to-date information. They will email us, but sometimes they'll put the information maybe on their Instagram or Twitter before we even know. So just keep that updated. With the dates and deadlines, the next slide, just want to make sure that everyone understands the difference between early action and early decision. Early decision is a binding decision. I always tell my students when they do early decision, they're deciding that that is their top school. And if they're accepted to that school, they need to rescind all their other applications. And so if a student is doing early decision for a college, that's binding. Within that, the colleges have made it a lot more complicated. Sometimes they have, well, there's early decision one and early decision two, but just know for anything with early decision, they are expecting students to stick to that. But there are some that are very complex, saying early decision for private schools, but you could still get your applications in for public schools. So, but with early action is just, you find out early. So it's just not any binding decision. Some have different deadlines for scholarships and honors. So you want to make sure that they're taking that into consideration. Most of the time, the early action deadlines are correlated with those deadlines for scholarships and honors colleges. And then there are some programs that may have early deadlines. And we just included a couple the examples, like I said, Ohio State's November 15th, UC is December 1st, and Miami is December 1st for early action. Early decision is a little different. With transcripts, hopefully everyone received the transcripts we put in the mail on August 10th. We are going to provide an updated transcript during the week of September 14th. This is really important for our students that did CCP classes over the summer, as well as BYU classes, because their GPA may change. We are slowly but surely getting grades in from those colleges. They don't come in as quickly as we would like. Actually, we reached out to one of the colleges and they said, well, we give our professors deadlines, but I don't know about you guys with your teachers, but with us, some of the professors don't keep with the deadlines. So they're trying to get those grades and they get them to the schools, and then we'll get them on the transcript. So we will send an updated transcript during the week of September 14th.
I wanted to review a few slides for especially COVID happening and everything, and people maybe looking at more like non-traditional pathways, or just maybe something a little different than the 2 or 4 year college. So each year students do express interest in military, and I have been in touch with one of the reps, like from the Air Force, and they are current, they do currently just like virtual only meetings, and they still have the same kind of fiscal cycle that they had last year. So that has not really like changed with COVID. So there still are like needs like within the military forces. If you do have a student who does have an interest in this, please have them get, please reach out to either one of us, and that we can help like facilitate that conversation. And then the other option that we're starting to hear like about too, next slide, yep, is the is the gap year, and so that is an opportunity to take like a break from coursework and to focus on like enriching life experiences, and that could include traveling, volunteering, working. There are no specific rules like in how like a student can structure this out. There are some high cost programs, and that there are individually tailored programs too. And so like just knowing too that like a student like can defer like enrollment for that specific college and still have a seat saved for them when they return.
Okay, this is one of the toughest ones about student owning it. We recognize that parents are typically funding this education, and so you want to make sure that you're a part of this process. What I have been on now more than ever, I've listened to a lot of webinars just because of how things are changing, and they constantly say, if you could please make sure that we are hearing from your students and not your parents, because the students is who, you know, we'll be educating, that's who we want to hear from. What I encourage parents to do, and what I do with my students when I maybe help them make a phone call or what have you, I'm there with them. I'm kind of letting them talk. And then if I need to insert something, because I know you want to make sure the information is being communicated properly and that you're getting accurate information. So if you want to, they're sending out an email, if you even want to be with them as they send the email out, just make sure that it's coming from them. And I mean, they've even talked about, we know the parents will write the emails. It's very clear this is not coming from an 18-year-old. I know sometimes some 18-year-olds or 17-year-olds are very mature in how they communicate. But, you know, that's just something we're trying to just make sure the students are owning that. So like I said, make the phone calls together, write the emails together. But this is not something that we're saying. This is something that the college reps often tell us and ask us to communicate to our parents. With the senior dates, like I said, I'm not going to go through all of this because it will be emailed. We've kind of broken it up with first semester, second semester. Just we do have the schedule pickup on the 27th. All of the seniors will need to come on the 3rd and 4th. The first half will come on the 3rd. The first half of the alphabet, I'm sorry, A through K and L through Z will come on the 4th. We have our financial aid meeting on the 22nd. And so we have a lot of dates there when graduate services we'll be here. That's where you get the class rings, grad invitations, cap and gown. So those dates will be very important. And then the next slide just shows those second semester dates. But please make sure you have on your calendars that exciting day of May 30th at 11 a.m. where we'll have graduation. May 30th, 11 a.m. will be graduation at the Centos Center, and graduation rehearsal, which is mandatory for all students, will be May 28th at 10:30. And then on May 26th is when they have that walk through the elementary school. I don't know if you guys have had older siblings, but that's older children that have graduated, but they've been in Sycamore and they walk back through Maple Dell and Sims. It's kind of a very emotional experience for a lot of the students. So we want to make sure that that's on the calendar there. So next, I'm going to go to the question and answers. And I know that Ms. Sanders was going to kind of type them up on the slide. So Ms. Sanders, I'm not sure if we're still doing it that way or if there are any.
Yeah, just one moment and then we'll get the questions going.
Okay.
I don't think I want to walk through my elementary school. That's going to make me upset. I can't hear. It's muted.
Mrs. Mitchell, Mr. Millett, I'm going to go ahead and start copying and pasting.
Okay, and what I'm going to try and do is just kind of scroll through myself and see. Hold on, a lot of this was about not being able to see Zoom presentation mode. The Remind app is for both students and parents. There are times when we will send things just to students. Like if I need to see a student in my office, it's just going to go to the student. But just like this morning when we sent out the UC Glender College of Business Honors, we sent it to both the students and the parents just so the parents can be aware that that was an option for them. Let's see. Remind app.
Go ahead. And Mrs. Mitchell, look at the last slide of your presentation. The questions are all there.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Okay. Can you put it in present mode so I can say it a little larger? Here we go here.
Oh,
wow. Okay. Okay, we have heard, I've heard from a few students about the ACT and the website and that the students have not been able to access those scores. We do, if the student took the ACT with us or without us, we do have access to those scores in our computer system. So if you need to ask your students to email the counselor, and we can easily do a screenshot of those scores and do that. But in regards to sending the official score, it still needs to come from ACT. I know a lot of students will put it in the common application. Some schools still feel that self-reporting, they need to see the actual score. Unfortunately, because ACT is kind of out of our realm, I don't know any other suggestions aside from that. But if they can't remember all their scores from the different sections, they can email Mr. Millett or myself, and we would be more than happy to do that.
Yeah, and I think we have some of the June scores back. I'm not really, I don't know if we do have the July scores and back yet. Okay. So just as a FYI.
Okay. Can you clarify the applications don't come up? Yes. Just make sure that when students go into overgrad, and it's a video on the pit stop. When they go into overgrad, they click add application, and then it shows the steps of how they request that transcript. So when we meet with the students, we will continually tell them that. And then if I'm in overgrad and I'm in Common App and I see some of the Common App schools have not been added in overgrad, I will be sending reminders to the students, you must list those schools. So they must be listed in overgrad, even if they have submitted their application through Common App.
For schools that say they no longer require tests or test optional, how will they factor in ACT scores into their decision process?
Yeah. So we, once again, all of the webinars I've attended, I was, for those students that have submitted a score, Are you sure students who don't submit scores will not be penalized? And they say they have always taken a holistic approach to looking at student applications. And so they're looking at all of those supplemental essay questions that they're asking students to answer. They're looking at the activities. They're looking at the recommendation letters. They are insisting the students will not be negatively impacted by not sending scores. And what I try to, you know, kind of tell my students, while Sycamore was fortunate where we were able to give the ACT in February before the crisis, schools across the country, some of them had not had that opportunity. And so some of them have not. I mean, students who are in Florida, Arizona, those students have not even had an opportunity to test. So there's no way they can penalize students for not submitting test
scores. Well, I want you over here, because they're right there, and they were starting to move.
But I think if there is a score that you have and that you want to share it.
Absolutely.
I think colleges would like to see that too. That gives them more information and education that they can work from.
Yeah. Any other questions?
Yeah, there's a couple more I added there on those slides.
Okay.
All right. Missed that.
Yep. I'm able to call and email. And do that.
So we sent 2 ACC scores, but.
The super score in regards to the ACT super scoring that ACT implemented after the September test, you can go back and do that, but you know, the colleges will a lot of the schools will super score. I can't say most. Some schools will super score. It's my understanding that you can only super score if you retake a test in September. And I've heard from students that some of those test centers have been, you know, full very quickly, you know, some as far as 60 miles away. So I don't think that it's, that it would warrant that, especially if you already have the two scores that have been submitted.
If you send out scores, do you have to send it to all schools or can you send it just to schools that require them?
Yes. So when you go into ACT and you put in the four digit code where to send the scores, but understand if you put those scores in the common application, those scores are going to all of those schools. You cannot designate within the common application if you're self-reporting what scores will go to what schools. But if you do the official report, you can do that.
Right, it goes to the specific schools you're sending to. Yep. And then the other question for early decision, do the schools tell you about scholarships at that time before you decline all of the other applications? I think typically students will not know that financial package, what they might be offered, before they make that decision. It is not going to be clear, and I have received a lot of questions about scholarships, and I don't know if there is going to be some kind of a COVID effect with that, with certain schools, and how that might change. They might stay the same. I really just do not know, but you will not know what that package is, the financial package, before you have to make that decision. All right, great. Are you noticing that a lot of 2020 seniors are choosing to take a gap year this year And will that affect the 2021 seniors getting into their colleges?
Yeah,
I haven't seen that.
And it's,
seen that being
it's
that
hard
much of a change.
Because we're not obviously the counselors for class of 2020. But one thing that I wanted to make sure that we mentioned with the gap year, we strongly encourage students to go through the application process and then defer their admission. So that way they can know what their options are. And if they decide to not attend for a year, that's fine. And colleges will typically allow students to defer for a year. So that way they'll still go through that application process. And those, that class of 2020 hopefully will not impact those admission spots. I mean, I was listening to a webinar from UConn, and they were over by 15 of their projected enrollment for freshmen. So that was kind of surprising to me. So for some schools, they have not seen a change in those number of students.
For a student who takes virtual lessons, how can they request teacher recommendation letters and transcripts?
So the recommendation letters are going to be done through common application. So virtual does not affect that. Obviously, they're not able to have that face-to-face conversation. And so they just simply email the teacher and say, you know, I would like for you to write me a letter of recommendation. If you're okay with that, I will invite you through the common application. So everything is done virtually that way.
So the phone for 2 hours trying to get assigned because scores have come directly from ACT and SAT. I'm not sure if that's a question.
Our students who, but aren't our kids being penalized who took the ACT and SAT test?
If they did well, if they won't even help them get it.
Well, I mean,
they still can share.
They
the
can
score.
Still share the score. So I think they're not. They're saying that they're definitely going to consider a score if a score is shared. They're just not going to. Negative for the students who do not share will not negatively, they will not having a score will not affect them getting admitted. So students can definitely still send their scores if they did well and they feel like it represents their ability, but it's more for the opposite. They're just simply saying, if you want to send, yes. If you don't send, it's not going to negatively impact the admissions.
I think the more information that you can share, though, that will be helpful.
Absolutely.
That gives them a more transparent picture of what's going on.
So the question about the super scoring is up to every individual school. So I can't say whether or not a school will super score or not. The best way to get that information is on the website. Unfortunately, I wish I could answer that, but
that's
I can't.
Representative, yep.
Okay. Well, we thank you guys so much for going through us with this process of doing it virtually. Obviously, I wish I could see faces and see you guys in the audience, but no, obviously, this is the medium that we have to use right now, and we'll do our best to work through it. As I said, we will send an email of this presentation to everyone. And what we do is we, in regards to the communication, we have the email that is the primary email in Blackboard. That is how everything is submitted. We just have an email for 12th grade parents and it's linked with that. So understand we also will have a copy of the presentation on our website. So even though we plan to email it, understand you will be able to access that on our
The 12th grade pit stop.
Mm-hmm.
Feel free to reach out to us with any other like additional questions and whatnot too. So.
Yes, and we will definitely have virtual meetings at this time.
Yep.
Outside adults are not allowed in the building, but we will have the virtual meetings that we will be able to schedule. Thanks
appreciate
so much for watching.
Time.
We appreciate
Thank
it.
You.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. And again, yes, be looking for an email with a lot of good information and look for a video this week from Mr. Mader as well, which will give a lot of really good visual information for face-to-face and some things about virtual too. So thank you. Feel free to email with any questions.